And when we get started, we're going to look at Psalm 1. We'll look at Psalm 6. We'll look at Psalm 1, John 6, John 8, and John 15. But here's what we're going to do tonight. I kind of just simplified this to knowing God in Scripture, or having an encounter, an experience with the Lord. And I want to give us a little focus on that, and then I want us to at least take the last 20 minutes, like about 10 after, so about 20 minutes to talk, 20 minutes to practice, because I'm believing Holy Spirit's going to give each one of us, it's not that I'm going to teach you something new, probably most of you will have heard all of these things. I might renew something that you've kind of not been thinking about, or connect some dots that haven't been, you know, they've been isolated experiences, or possibly say something that is new to your thinking. But it's so that we can journey into the truth of what Christ has already accomplished, and to enjoy who he is, the union that we have been given. I mean, we've been given absolute union, but it's there positionally that we haven't yet necessarily experienced it, and that's the process that we're all involved in, to come into to where we are enjoying it, where we're living from that place. And the Scripture has got to be the most profound part of this, because without truth, we're just going to be all over the map all the time, because we don't have a place to always start from and a place to always return to, because truth never changes, and the words that Jesus spoke are true. So I want to take you to Psalm 1 really quickly. Do a little bit of teaching, then a little bit of exercises, and then some practice with the Scripture. Because my goal is that everybody will have been, we've been given, we'll just be reinvigorated to go into knowing God inside Scripture. So Father, I thank you, and Holy Spirit, I ask you to come powerfully, because it was your ministry, Jesus told us, that you would come and do these very things that we're endeavoring to step into tonight. That you would come and reveal and guide and teach. You would explain. You would give. You would cause the things that have been given us in Christ to become ours. You would put us into remembrance. You would literally be the one that makes Jesus become real for us. So, Lord, we ask you for that. Father, we are not negligent to remember that Jesus said that no man comes to Jesus unless the Father draws him. So, Father, will you draw us right now? Draw each of us here online to Jesus. Jesus, we remember that you said no man knows the Father unless you, the Son of Man, wills to reveal him. So we ask you, Jesus, reveal the Father to us tonight. We do not want to just apply ourselves. We want to yield ourselves to you, Holy Spirit, to you, Heavenly Father, to you, our Lord Jesus. Jesus, you told us that you were going to make a place for us, prepare a place, and come and receive us so that where you are, we may be also. That's our prayer tonight. Where you are, we want to be also. Who you are, we want to become also. So, Lord, open our eyes that we can see. Help our eyes to open right now. Open our ears that we can hear. Help us to hear right now. And give us hearts that understand perception. And let us turn to what we understand in our hearing, seeing, and understanding. And may healing, may true exchange of God begin to take hold. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, amen. Okay, so Psalm 1. Just read the first three verses. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. So that's where we're not to be. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. The word meditate, let me just give you the quick definition to that. I put all my notes today on my phone, so we'll see how that works. It comes from the Hebrew word hagah. And it means, it's a primitive root, and it literally means to murmur or mutter in pleasure or anger. So the Hebraic thought of meditation was it was an active, like participation, processing. We do muttering, murmuring real good in the negative. None of us probably have trouble doing that. We complain on the way here. We complain over there. We complain about this. We just kind of, well, the opposite, taking that same kind of practice, but turning it in toward that of Scripture, it's part of like what they used to say, look at a cow who they have like 6 or 7 stomachs, and it would take and eat, and then it would put its cud back up and chew it, and then swallow it again, and up and chew it again, and swallow it again. It's a processing of absorbing, or in literally, in some many cases, being absorbed by what we're learning. And the fruit of it is huge. It says, he will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth its fruit in its season, whose leaves also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff with which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. So every day when I wake up, when we wake up, we all have a day ahead of us. And we have choices to go into that day with the best resources we have. It may be the day we don't want to walk into. It may be the day we've been looking forward to for a long time. But there's one thing that we can always access, and that's we can go to be with the Lord and have that which we've called our quiet time, our devotional time, our prayer time, and encounter God. And in that encounter, our life can become back into union and communion with who we have been given in Jesus Christ. We can come into, I often say, we can become recalibrated back to truth, come out of the reality I may be in and back to the truth that I've been given. And so Scripture is just the hugest thing. Now, they say that we tend to either be math people or language people. You know, we tend to love science or we tend to love the languages. Now, I would to God, when I went to school, I would have paid attention to English and learned something. I didn't. And I'm a math person. So everything I am practicing and anything I share is not my nature. But it's kind of something I've learned to move to discover, to learn God. Because God is all. He's math and language, but he's huge in language. Because he actually calls himself the Word. So he's big into language. So we're going to talk about activating our language in the presence. So for me, it will probably be now, I don't know, 10, 15 years ago, Cammy believes, and I agree with her, that there was a season that for 6 months I read the Song of Songs out loud every morning to the Lord. And I would read, and I would be the Shulamite, and I would be the beloved, and I would be the daughters of Jerusalem, and I would be every character. And it's a really, I just was reading it as an intentionality to find the banquet of wine to attract the king. And while I did that, I would then put myself into the voices as best I could. I was in the sanctuary all alone, dark and early in the morning, nobody here. And I would just go through these parts. And something happened that I did not plan to have happen. I began to enter into these people. I began to enter into the emotions, the experience. I began to find what I was reading that was kind of abstract. Began to connect to a subjective place that I currently felt. I began to connect in ways my mind couldn't connect. And I wouldn't have been able to jump into the emotion of it. It was too abstract. So something from a faraway situation began to come very close and personal and have relevance to the very things I was walking through. So that was pretty cool. Then 5 years ago, in October, it'll be 5 years this October, that I had that encounter where the Lord called me up to, and in the conversation, he said, you've done well to learn to abide, but you don't stay here. You abide for a while, and then you're going to try to do something. And I want you to make a choice. Either abide or go do. I don't mind. But again, every time the Lord usually asks us a question, it's already on an answer, a question he asked us a long time ago to an answer we gave him a long time ago. He's not really trying to change your course. He's trying to get you back on course. So he got me back on course and really supernaturally helped me. I mean, for a sovereign 5 months, he kept me in just his presence and in delight and in joy. While that time, I began to revisit promises and scripture. And to my fascination and joy was I found that all the scriptures that I had at times before read, memorized, and tried to go do, but had to let go because I couldn't do and it failed miserably. But these scriptures were still just vibrantly alive as though they had never been tarnished by my failure. They had never expired because of my inability to get to the expiration date. They were just alive, and they were vibrantly alive. And in that season, a real clear paradigm shifted, that I understood that for so many years, I would read this Bible and try to do it. So I would really apply my cognitive abilities. I mean, I've been a person who could receive revelation from the very beginning of my journey, so it wasn't like I wasn't in revelation, but I would always then go from revelation to application. Like Peter in John 16, I immediately knew, or Matthew 16, knew where we should go with this. So I would read to observe to do. Now I was discovering that I was actually supposed to read to behold and become. I wasn't trying to take on scripture as something I was responsible to do. I was now letting scripture to become something that I was discovering of who God was. And so what I used to read, like the fruit of the Spirit was the first place that just was a paradigm. I had to, I'll be honest, I didn't even know all the 9 fruits. I tried to memorize them many times, but they'd never attached themselves because they were, to me, a to-do list of being a good Christian. And I failed by the time I got to 4. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering. That was too hard to do, right? So I kind of gave up after that, your defeat in the beginning. So then the kindness, who wants to try to go into kindness and all of that, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, But all of a sudden, I found that they were the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So I worshiped God with the scriptures, ascribing to God that he was love, joy, peace, long-suffering. And now the pressure wasn't on me to become more long-suffering. It was to observe and ascribe to God as the one who is long-suffering. So a lot of shifts started happening. Now, if you go with me to John 6, most recently, in these last 5 years, if I was to describe what is the most revolutionary thing that has occurred in this practice of abiding, I would have to say it is his word abiding in me. That place that I believe is the place Jesus has prepared and the place where the Father dwells with us and the mansions that he's prepared for us to be for him it cannot be altered. So no matter what my day was yesterday, if I begin again today and incline myself to be with the Lord and meet him in truth, I'm right back in the same wonderful discovery I was in the day before, the day before, the day before. But each day's discovery grows in wealth and experience. Now, John 6, Jesus had done a wonderful miracle. He'd fed everyone. They wanted him more, to feed him more. He started to shift them from getting a lunch to eating and partaking of who he had become to be, manna from heaven. They got offended, couldn't follow that. It's a glorious conversation. Finally, he's coming to the place where he's having to say, you're just not getting it because you just don't understand. He says in John 6, verse 63, it is the spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Powerful proclamations. But there are some of you who do not believe, for Jesus knew who from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. And he said, therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it's been granted to him by my Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. He had hit them with some pretty abstract thoughts, like eating his flesh and drinking his blood. And they weren't able to grapple with this, so they began to back away from him. Now go to John 8, verse 31. This is a repeated theme, especially in the Gospel of John. In John 8, 31, Jesus said to those Jews who believed in him. Now, each case, these conversations are with those who have come to an initial faith in who he was and what he was about. He said to those Jews who believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Now, that is a glorious invitation, but it hit an oblique angle of a people who were living under a Roman oppressive state, who had created their own image that they were indeed free to live. And they got challenged by this statement. And they go into an argument with Jesus to the point that they're calling him names. You know, he's, you know, illegitimately born. All this stuff. Till they finally get to this heated argument. They want to stone him. And at one point, down verse 43, he says, "Why do you not understand my speech? Because you are not able to listen to my word." Now, the thing about, we used to say, and I still like saying it, that God offends the mind to reveal the heart. He hits you in an angle that makes you react in a fashion that is more for you to see where you currently really are than it is for you to be able to maintain your place. He offends the mind to reveal the heart. So now, there in this quandary, John 15, he's speaking to his disciples on the way to Gethsemane. And he says, "I am the true vine," and verse 1, "and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You're already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. For a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. He abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. But for without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather and throw him into fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples." So in these three chapters, and there are more chapters in the Gospel of John, the connecting point and the growing point was from the abiding in the word abiding in us. And each one of them was a mark of a disciple or the challenge to the disciple. In one case, the disciples began to back away. Another case, those who were just entering into discipleship got snagged on this technicality about who are you calling not free. And in this case, his disciples are really he's trying to give them his best language by saying, "Okay, I'm the vine, you're the branch, we're going to hold ourselves in union. Union looks like this. You abide in me, my words abide in you." And the word abide, we'll look at the end of the evening, has such powerful sound. It means to stay in a given place or state or relation or expectancy. So if I am to stay in a given place in his word, in a relation in his word, in a position in his word, in expectancy of his word, that's not, you begin to see that the word becomes a more tangible place of union than it's just something I'm learning about God and marking that I want to become like that or I got to do that. It's really a place of union. So let me do some practice things that you'll enjoy these. These aren't hard. It says, the soul is meant to magnify the Lord. But the soul will magnify anything it's focused on. And in the culture and the day we live in, with all the stress on the earth, we're magnifying a lot of terrible things in our soul. And we don't want to, but we just don't know how to get out of it. But the good news about the Word of God and the truth of God is the truth, when muttered, when really engaged with words, will cause our soul to listen, and our soul will begin to actually agree with it, even with you out, without us trying to make it do it. That's why we don't have to try to change our thinking. We just have to choose to place a connecting point with Scripture. And I'll share with that how that we can do that. But let's practice some things we all know. I want you to think of a sunset. A sunset you enjoyed, place, and I want you to, we're going to practice muttering. I want you to describe it to yourself. Where was it? When was it? What did it look like? How were you feeling? Okay, so look, close your eyes. You're now all alone. You're back at your sunset. And just take about a moment and describe to yourself where it was, when was it, what were you feeling, who were you with, and just give as much of a description of that sunset. We'll do another one. If I was describing the sunset to you, or you describing your sunset to me, the more words you gave me would be the more ability for me to enter into that sunset, that experience. You could tell me where it was, but you might not tell me who you were with. And you could tell me where it was and who you were with and when it was and what the weather was like. And then if you told me how you had been feeling that day and what it made you feel like that evening, I would begin to enter into an experience you'd already had, and I would have that experience to a degree. And that's what our soul starts to do if we can find a way to describe truth. Truth begins, our hearing ourselves describe truth allows us to enter into the truth experientially. But let's try another one. Take a moment and describe a time to yourself recently when you had a fearful moment. A moment of anxiety. It could be a huge moment, or it could have been just a passing moment. But describe that moment. Again, no one's listening but yourself. Okay. Again, if you were to share that story with somebody else, the more you gave details, the more you told where it was, when it was, how you got there, what had happened, what were the reasons you were feeling those feelings, what did it trigger, where did that trigger mechanism originate, why are you always, you could just really include somebody inside of you, who you are. And by just telling it to yourself, you re-entered into it. And sometimes we get in these traumas, we can't get out of them. They're awful. So let's do something positive. Think about something that a recent time you had a revelation or an insight or something you saw of God or heard about God that lifted your heart, gave you hope. When was the last time? Just try to describe it and things around it. Okay. One more. I want you to think about your favorite place to eat, where you enjoy dinner, or a meal you like, or a meal you had once. It could go all the way back to childhood. It could be anything. But just pull out a favorite place to eat, a favorite meal, a favorite time, and now describe it. best you can. Now, before we leave this, take a moment and smell and taste. Remember the feelings of that pleasure, the joy, the warmth. If it's company you're with, if it's a location, just take a moment and savor it, smell it, taste it. It's a past moment, but it's still there. Okay. What we're tapping into is the beauty of our imagination to go to places that have already been true experiences that we've had or true emotions. Now, I want you to imagine with me a valley or an enclosed garden, place of great beauty. And it's close enough to your house that you can walk there. And one day you discover it. And it's lush, there's waterfalls, there's whatever you would love to find in a valley. There's flowers, there's grass, there's animals, there's beauty, there's tranquility. You don't even know how it could be there in the middle of your suburb, but there it is. And you meet the owner, and the owner is thrilled that you've come to the valley and you delight. And he says, basically, come anytime you want. This actually is what I've always made this place for. This is my garden. I want you to enjoy it. Come. So now here's a thought. If you discovered that and were given permission to go there, and it was within walking distance to your home, well then, would there be any reason to keep you? Other than we might feel we're too busy, or we don't know if he really meant we should go there. But now let's think about the positive. What if you made that like a part of your practice? Like every, couple, three, four times a week, you went and just spent some time there. Now, wouldn't after about 3 months of going there, would you know that place better than the first time you discovered it? Would you be tired of it? Probably not. Not if it's a paradise. Not if it's a beautiful place of tranquility, because it would bring for you rest, resolve, refreshing. And there it was. And you probably would see things you had never seen before, right? Isn't that true about things when we really find something precious? It's like every time we go back, it's like, oh, that's even better than I thought it was. And wow, did you see how these connect? Well, that's kind of like the word. Let me see where I am. Now, one more picture. Imagine you had an inheritance given to you. That's wherever you want to have a place. We'll use Paso Robles, and you were given a vineyard with a winery or orchards with apples, whatever your preference. Apple stand, a winery, a beautiful home, but it's not yours yet to come and live there, but you can visit as often as you want. It's yours. It's going to be yours. It's an inheritance, but it's just not fully transferred in the level that you could just go turnkey and stay there. But you have a key and you can go in there anytime. Again, we might think, well, it's really not valuable yet to me because it's not really something I can make changes in or do things I want. So I'm just going to kind of wait till that day it becomes mine. Or I might be so thrilled with this future inheritance that I started driving up there every weekend and walking the grounds and discovering the way it is and how it functions and going through the seasons. Now, if I chose to do that and spend all those weeks and months and years prior to my receiving my inheritance, would I be better prepared to walk into it than if I had just been told I had it and then one day I'm being kind of told here it is? Right? There's so much about the trafficking or traveling or treading about that really makes a difference. So here we're going to practice this now for the next 20 minutes. What I'd like to do is I'd like to use those three scriptures that we did in John 6, 8, and 15. When I meditate, I can meditate on who God is, which is my primary joy, because he becomes who I am. I become who he is. I become conformed. So it's a joy to give pleasure to him. I can also talk about what he's promised to do. I can meditate on that. And I was thinking of doing that, but the problem, I felt the Lord said, no, I want you just to practice meditating on the truth of my word. Because if you understand what the word is, then you'll be quick to use it as a door. It is the wardrobe into Narnia. It's the door into the discovery of things that you could live hearing about all your life, but all of a sudden you walk through and it's there, and then you walk back through another time and another time. So let's go to John 6:63. Now, Sam, if you'll keep the scripture on so those online can practice if they don't have a Bible, and if you're driving, well, if you're driving, you shouldn't be looking at your screen anyway, but that's just, I want us to have the scripture, John 6:63, and I want us to meditate that. Now let me give you just five ideas that meditation can be involved in when you're doing it. When I meditate, I try to, like just one scripture, I try to gaze upon it and take it all in. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. So I kind of look at it. I'm not trying to extrapolate. I'm not trying to define. I'm just trying to observe. That's a beginning point. Often, if I'm doing that, my attention gets drawn to something. I don't know why it is. It's just like looking at a painting, and your attention's drawn to a part of the painting or a scenery. That's the Holy Spirit usually, because these are, well, first off, it says the words that I speak are spirit and they are life. Just think about that. You mean your words you're speaking, Jesus, are living, they're the pneuma, and they are life, which is the word zoe. They're living spirit. And so I get drawn to a part of it, like that, let's say that. Now I have interest. My interest is stirred, and that's a real part of meditating, because you kind of go, wow, I wonder what life means. And you might then use a concordance or a Bible. It's like I call it take a closer look at what you see. And if you have a concordance on your phone, it's just a fabulous invention. Next to Mr. Strong doing all the work, now this on the phone is just the best. You can look. And sometimes the scripture will bring to my remembrance something from another day that I'd heard, and I want to go back to that. Or it might bring me into something that flows with that, spirit and life, worship you in spirit and truth, wonder how truth and life connect. But what I'm doing is I'm entering into the scripture, but not by using my mental abilities or my cognitive. I'm letting myself be led, but I'm following where I'm being led, and I'm exploring where I'm being led. When I start to discover something that's just like, oh, that's really cool, I want to ascribe it back to God. I want to give it back to him, to think that, God, you would be so willing to make your son flesh, and that he would then speak words that are spirit and life. And now that every time I meet Jesus, in any occasion, I can anticipate that he's going to speak spirit and life. He may talk about flesh and blood that I have no clue what he's talking about, but he's speaking spirit and life. You see, and I don't allow myself to be stuck on that scripture. I can go on to other scriptures. These sometimes are just a diving board. I read down a little further, and the apostles, the disciples said, we're thinking about leaving, but there's no place to go because you have the words of eternal life. Then it caught my attention one day that disciples said, we're not leaving you because you have words of eternal life, and we've come to believe you are the Christ. That meant that they already had settled that you were the Christ, but that wasn't why they were staying. They were staying because he was talking eternal life. And they were feeding on eternal life through the words he was speaking. So it just kind of has a possibility of taking us to discovery. And that discovery, then, we allow it to find emotion. So the last thing I like to do in ascribing to the Lord, is to, you know, to describe back to him what I'm saying and pause again and see and hear and breathe it in. So let's go ahead and try that for just a couple minutes, and then we'll do another verse. So you can use your Bible, and you can let this be a launch. If this is a scripture that doesn't do anything for you, but there is one that's stirring your heart, please go there. And I'll say a few words, but tune me out. I just do it for the people online. So Heavenly Father, bless the sound and allow these words to come forth and be a point of entrance for each of us, individually and corporately, we pray. In Jesus' name. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. Remember to use your mouth to say just quietly what you're seeing. You're, again, describing, because that's going to help your soul to enter in or surrender to what you're describing. Thank you, Jesus. At times we describe what we don't understand. Lord, how can you be spirit and life? Words. That's part of a conversation. It's good. Sometimes emotions start to be a language that you feel from the words you're reading, meditating. Let the emotion come forth. And sometimes you might feel desire to look up something else. Please be free to do so. Follow the cord. Take a moment, pause, look over what you've seen or felt. Ascribe to the Lord, this is what I'm becoming aware of in the scripture, what I'm hearing, what I'm seeing. Thank him for it. We'll just kind of put a Selah on that, and we'll go to John 8 for a minute. John 8. 31 and 32. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Pause and take a big look, gaze upon it, see what attracts you. Move to where you're attracted. Might be a word that you want to understand. If you abide in my word, what does that abide mean? Or word? Is it the rhema or the logos? It's literally the logos. What is freedom? What does it mean to make? am I being reminded of? What is it? What is it touching? It might be painful or it might be hope-filled. What does it mean to know? Again, it's just following it until you need to discover another point. It's kind of like hopping stones in a creek. Look for the next stone to land on. Again, it's emotions are powerful, so let them rise. Bring them to the Lord. Let truth speak to. Again, we have just a short time, but back, take a gaze, take an overlook again. Breathe in. Ascribe back to the Lord, thank you. Tell him what you saw. What was it that just drew you to his attention? Our words are rudders, and that's why we use our words in communing. It's just a whisper, a breath, but it's still a word. Not just thinking. Especially if our thinking is in a bad track, you've got to use your words. Shabbat. Okay, close that one and let's go to John 15, and then we'll pull the three together. John 15, 5 through 8. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. Take a look over the scenery of that. What catches your attention? Move. Take a look, listen, behold. Wow, yeah. Your imagination can allow you to see what fruitfulness would look like, feel like. Abiding in Christ and his words abiding you might look like, what asking whatever you will and it be done for you might be like. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. Now just pause and without disconnecting, connect the three experiences. John 6, John 8, John 15. You don't have to remember verbatim anything, but just what was it that John 6 you saw or felt or drawn to? Pull it up. Describe it. What happened in John 8? What did you see there? Drew your attention. Pull it up. Describe it. And what was it in John 15 that you, your attention was drawn to? What did you see? What did you experience? That's like finding three beautiful stones on the seashore. Take a moment and look at the three of them in your hand and see how they are, compare, or how uniquely distinct they are, how each have their own beauty, but maybe they also have a commonality. It's all about his beautiful word we're meditating on, but the things he said about his word and what it brings and what he does and how we respond. In a way, like David, when he went to the brook and got his five stones to kill Goliath, this is very much the things that give us this ammunition of life. Now with you, if you're looking at them, take a moment and acknowledge that this is who God is. This is his provision of himself to you. This is not what he's, not what we're to do, but what he's giving us, what he's providing for us. And just thank him. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what you've given us in just short 12 minutes of meditation. And we ask you in the Holy Spirit to help expand our capacities and experiences and multiply them until we are bearing the fruitfulness that would make our Father so pleased and prove to be his disciples. We ask that where our minds have been ravaged over time, our souls have been trampled underfoot by man, our life has met too many disappointments to rise up again, that truth would begin to again rise up as a champion. And we would not be trying to force truth, but we would come under the refuge of truth and hide ourselves inside of truth. We thank you, Jesus, that these things that we've read tonight are yours, that you give to us. They cannot be lost and they cannot be stolen. They are eternal and they are returnable too. So, Lord, I pray that from here, you would launch us tomorrow or launch us right to the place you want to begin our own new journey. But we give you permission and desire to meet you in spirit and in truth, to worship you here and become one in the union that you've provided. Bless everyone online. Secure us as we drive home and hold these places that you've prepared for us, that you allowed us into tonight, to return and grow and become that secret garden, that valley, lush valley that we've become familiar with, that inheritance that's been given us. In Jesus' name. Amen.